So the orange line on this graph shows the underlying price per hectare of sheep and beef land. It is a wee bit out of date. It finished at 2009, but it's certainly carried on since then. Whereas the blue line there shows the actual effective hectares of the average farm. And between 1987 and 2009, there you can see a really clear trend in that the average size of these farms has increased by 30%. So, you know, the economic unit, it just continues to get larger and hence less affordable to young farmers coming through. Now, we have had a lift in farm gate returns, maybe not as enough or not as fast as many of you would like, but certainly in the likes of lamb and dairy, there's been a considerable increase. Taking dairy for a start, between 1995 and 2010, the average payout rose by 40%. And if you were to project that forward to, well, forget about this year's payout, but look at next year, at more a $7 mark, we'd be talking a 50% increase in payout over that period, whereas lamb over the same period has actually kept pace pretty well. It's also gained in value by approximately 50 to 60%. So, you know, not only are these farms larger and more expensive per hectare, but the turnover of the business is actually growing pretty substantially too on the way through. So they're getting much more complex and there's a lot more at stake. The other side of the coin is the debt market. And until the GFC hit, New Zealand rural debt was actually growing at 15% per annum. So we've got capital gain was going at 13%, but debt was going at 15. You can see pretty clearly that bank debt was the major driver of that that increase in land prices. There wasn't too much profit going in there. And I like to think of one of Hayley Moynihan's favourite quotes when I sort of talk about this point. And she's convinced that New Zealand farmers are the best in the world at actually converting profit into land price. And that's what we do. We take it straight out and we put it straight back in. And we've certainly seen that again this year. A bit of an increase in the dairy payout, and away we go again. Oh, that's not good. Yeah. Oh, what does that cost me? Right. Where were we? So where we are today, that debt market, or the New Zealand rural debt market, sits at $50 billion. And we are now getting watched pretty closely by the Reserve Bank. I would suggest that's a level that they're starting to get a little uncomfortable with. On an actual deal basis, or with my day-to-day job, what we're seeing coming across our desk, any of these sheep and beef operations with a bit of scale, most applications that are going up are around $400 a stock unit of debt, maybe a little bit more. 5-6 years ago, that would have been 250 to 300. So the game's certainly shifting there. We are definitely seeing a more of a shift to profit-based thinking, and that farmers are looking to generate a true cash return out of properties, or they're looking for a genuine lift in carrying capacity and to generate a return through there. So there is less reliance on capital gain. And we're starting to get to the point where returns on investment are openly being discussed, particularly if it's under a partnership type situation. And I think you saw a good example of that last night with the Gardine family. You know, 6.8% return on capital through that period of time was an excellent result and well ahead of what the industry would be doing. So just deviating from a presentation a little bit at that, I was a wee bit concerned that when we got to question time at the end of that presentation last night, that all the questions were about the drones. You know, fantastic profitability, and we didn't take the opportunity to dig into that a little bit deeper. So I'm not sure if that's a confidence thing or it's a knowledge gap thing or what it is, but as an industry, I think we need to sort it out. And you know, maybe that's something the PTP needs to dig into a little bit deeper. All right, so I've got two questions for you today. If you're on the way up, then how are you going to grow in this environment? Or on the other side of the coin, if you're on the way out, who's going to buy your farm when you retire? And what do you want to see happen to it? It might seem pretty basic, but I think we need to start thinking about that a bit differently. So let's think about growth in a business. You know, we all know that if we stand still, we're dead. Basically, businesses have to keep growing, they have to keep evolving to move forward and to at least maintain the current standard of living that we're enjoying. The traditional approach has always been basically to borrow as much as you can, go it alone, leverage the farm up and stretch into a bit of land neighbouring or maybe sell and go to a slightly bigger property. And it's been successful, particularly for the banking industry. I often think that I end up with more money in my pocket than you guys do in yours under this strategy. And you know, you're doing the work, not me. Under this approach, if you manage to increase your land size by, say, a third to a half in any one particular move, you've done pretty well and you'll be probably fairly well maxed out. So you will, you know, you will get there, you will make it, but yet growth is going to be pretty slow. Like that move is going to set you back for a reasonably long period of time. So why do we keep doing it? Why don't we start considering an alternative approach, something that's a bit more balanced? What about a partnership? You know, why not pool their equity and take a slice of a bigger pie, one that's less highly geared, generates more cash, and has the potential to grow faster? You know, your own equity inside one of these partnerships or setups will probably grow a lot faster than it would by trying to do it by yourself. And to me, this equally applies whether you're trying to get into farming or whether you're exiting on the way out the other side. You know, if you are thinking of exiting, do you really need all your cash out at once? You know, what are you going to do with it when you do get it out? What sort of return are you happy to accept? You know, interest rates in the bank aren't that flash. You know, is there a better use for that capital that could actually help you grow your equity at the same time and get a kick out of bringing someone else through? You know, we need to start thinking differently. So what I'm keen to do today is just to run through a few real life examples, and you'll have to bear with me a bit. I've had to change from lessees to lessors, and I had people's names in here and they were all happy with it, but the legal guy said no. So I'll try and explain it as best I can on the way through. What I'm going to do today is really focus more on leasing type options, lease to buy type options, and actually stay away from equity partnerships. And that I think farmers as a whole are starting to get a pretty good handle on equity partnerships and how they fit together. They're certainly becoming reasonably common. I know that out of the Gore branch in the last 6 months, we'll have settled three equity partnerships, one dairy, two sheep and beef. One of those sheep and beef properties has quite a significant deer development as a component of it. And I would expect out of our branch in Gore, probably by the end of next year, that 10% of our lending will be in equity partnerships. It's probably sitting about 7% today, so I don't know how that flows through the rest of the bank, I just know that's where we sit. So the first example I want to run you through is a lease to buy. Now, this was a situation where there's a farming family in West Otago running about 3,500 stock units, which for that area is relatively small. Quite a small holding. They had a son that's been away working in the high country and all around the place for probably about 10 years, busting his gut to get home and get involved with the business, but just struggling to find the right opportunity. Not that far away from there, we had another client who was looking to retire. He'd bought a smaller block he wanted to shift to. He had no family coming through of his own, but didn't really want to sell a farm. And that farm, around about 650 hectares, 5,000 odd stock units over in the Lawrence District. So a property mainly a breeding property, but had some good scale about it. So after sort of bringing these guys together and working through the process, we came up with a bit of a solution whereby the family looking to grow bought as much of the land holding as they could, which in this case was only 14%. So with the owner, they formed a new company to own the land and took a 14% stake, which it may not sound like a lot, but it's a good start. They then went and purchased the vendor's livestock and plant and leased the farm off that company, so they were able to run that farm in with their own farmer of 3,500 stock units. So in one move, when you think about it, they've gone from, you know, running 3,500 stock units to nearer to 9,000 stock units without overly extending themselves from a debt point of view. Now, it's a 5-year lease term with a first right of renewal at the end of it, or a first right of purchase, I should say, at the end of it. And just to keep things balanced and make sure that there's some opportunity actually to increase the land stake or the ownership stake at the end of it, the land value has been capped. It could have risen up to 20% to protect the guys, I guess, coming in, that it wasn't getting away from them too much. But by the same token, it couldn't fall below 10%. And this farm was bought in 2010. So where they are, they're actually at the end of year four now, and they're starting to talk about how they keep this thing going. You know, there's a real willingness for this venture to succeed. It's gone really well, and the likely outcome is that the guys coming in will increase their shareholding in the farm or in that company that owns the land to somewhere near the 50% mark. So I guess the point I'd like to make here is that in the succession. And where I think it's heading within New Zealand, it's going to be pretty unlikely that we're going to get to the final answer in one move. There could be a number of moves along the way till we get to that final point. So they're renegotiating it now, and they'll probably set it for another 5-year lease term and carry on. Now, the thing to me is, you know, there was a good win-win created here. You know, the guys coming in, they generated much more scale than they would have been able to do by themselves. They did it at a lower level of debt than if they'd tried to do it themselves, and as a result, they've generated much more cash on the way through. Now, that's given them the opportunity to leverage further at this point. On the other side of the equation, the farmers that were exiting, you know, they've earned a really good lease income on the way through, and they have actually picked up that 20% capital gain, or they will over that 5% period. And you add the two of those together, obviously the capital gain's not taxed. You know, their return's going to be close to 10% per annum through that over the last 5 years. Now, what would they have got if they'd put that cash in the bank? A big part of this example was the goodwill right the way through. And there was a thing that happened right at the start that sort of set it off on the right foot, and that when the guys bought the stock at valuation, they believed the valuation was too low, and they actually offered to pay the vendor more than what they had to at the start. Now, in return, he thought that was pretty good. He took the extra cash that he got from the stock and he ploughed it back into capital fertiliser. So it got the whole thing off to a great start, and that's continued all the way through. Righto, a second example is more vendor finance lease. Now, this was a situation where we had a very good West farm manager, again based in West Otago. He'd been working in the district for a long time, great reputation, good stockman, but really limited savings and no opportunity or no family backing that he could leverage off. You know, people wanted to see him get ahead, and it was known that he was out there and looking for an opportunity. On the other side of the coin, we had a fairly astute farmer who had his farm leased for a number of years, had a manager in place for a number of years. Hadn't been going that well. He really did want to step back a bit, but didn't want to sell the property. Again, property with good scale. 630 hectares, 7,000 stock units, again, in that sort of South Otago area. And it certainly was running well below potential. There was a lot of upside in this property. What they've managed to come up with is an 8.5-year lease, and you might ask why the half year. Frankly, the farm was really messy when he went in, and to go in and lease it from day one, that first 6 months he'd have been on a hiding for nothing. So they've basically given him that 6 months rent-free on the condition that he started straight away. And so now he's actually, we're just getting to the end of that rent-free period now, and he's got a tidy ship to start with. The actual rental of this property has been set at a reasonably low level, but there's some really clear expectations around how the farm's to be developed, and it's up to that lessee that's coming in to develop the property and to pour that capital in. Now, the biggest hurdle for most guys, particularly when they're going into a farm of this property, is how do they actually fund that livestock on the way through? And it's usually the toughest ones for the banks to get around too, because as you will be aware, we can lend up to 50% on livestock, but that still leaves a fairly big chunk of capital that someone's got to come up with. So in this case here, the purchase of those livestock's actually been financed by the vendor, or the guy leasing the farm. And they've basically, the livestock, they're all valued on day one, but the payment for those stock has been spread out over 5 years, and in the interim he'll be paid 4% per annum on the cash that's outstanding. So that's a way of getting around that bank requirement of security up front. And you know, cash-wise it works fine. It's just trying to twist things a little bit to get them across the line. The lease term in that case is 2 + 3 + 3 years, and at every renewal it can only go up by 10 or down by 10%. So like I say, we're in year one now. Again, the lessee's achieved very good scale, but he's most important for them is they've been actually helped over that hurdle of purchasing capital livestock. So they're going to come out at the end of this lease with a good whack of equity in their own right. On the other hand, the lessee will know that this farm's going to go forward. It's certainly going to go forward. Ultimately, he's going to achieve a higher sale price at the end of the day, but he's still picking up a pretty good income on the way through. And look, down the track, who knows where this could develop. It could continue for a number of years longer than that. Just to finish on, there's a trading partnership scenario, and this is something that's probably pretty simple to achieve in most businesses. We had a situation here where we had a long-term manager who'd been on a property for many years, doing a pretty good job, but he was starting to get itchy feet. You know, he was really looking for somewhere to go. On the other side of the coin, the guys that own the farm, they're farmers in their own right elsewhere. They loved having this guy about. They just knew that while he was there, the place was being looked after. They didn't have to worry about it. And they were really keen to do the most they could to retain him. Again, that particular property, 550 hectares, 5,000 stock units in south Otago. What happened here was the managers actually bought 50% of the livestock and plant, so they borrowed money from the bank to do that. They were supported by the farm owner in that case to get that across the line. And they formed a new trading partnership with them. So basically they went 50-50 in the trading entity and continued to lease the farm off the family trust. That continued for 5 years. Until the farm was sold to take up some other opportunities. Now, over that period of time, the managers on that place, they actually doubled their equity in the livestock, and that was sufficient for them to go on and buy a sort of a semi-retirement block. The farm owners actually bought another property not that far from where the managers ended up, and they continue to work for them today. So that's a pretty good outcome all round. Key point for me in this one was that even though those guys have been in place on the same property for a long period of time, that subtle change in ownership and giving that manager a stake in the business and the ability to think about things a bit more and get on with the job, production lifted 10%, working costs actually dropped back 8%, and we had a net increase of around about an 18% in EBIT on the way through. And so the point there is that you just can't underestimate the extra you will get out of people by giving them a stake in the business on the way through. So what about the dairy industry? Where do we fit in all of this? Well, when I look at it, here's what I know. Look, you guys are very, very well connected. I think we're very well organised, and I think there's a pretty clear plan there from the top as to where we're going. No one can dispute that you've got a base of very passionate and motivated farmers. You know, if you weren't, we wouldn't be here. Simple as that. We know that there are some very profitable operations there. Yes, there's some challenges there at the moment, but we're really confident there's plenty of upside to come. And we know that we're innovators. You know, Andy's, we've got the slides there to prove it. You know, we do punch above our weight in terms of innovators and early adopters. So from my point of view, if anyone's going to pick up this sort of stuff and run with it, you know, it's got to be us. Why couldn't we do it? Why can't we be the ones creating that that win-win situation? And you know, my challenge to you is to start thinking about it, whatever level of your farming careers you're at, and think about, you know, how can we do this differently? Because we're simply going to have to. Just quickly, how can we help? We've got a number of different programs and things in place where we aim to keep farming going and succession ticking along into the future. And these are, while they're operated under Rabobank, they're certainly available to everybody. The Farm Ownerships Options program is what Brent's directly responsible for. That's sort of taken over from our equity partnership database. Looking at different ways and means of getting guys into farms. Our succession planning service, we have Tony Hammington's our South Island facilitator, and we've just recently appointed a North Island person who's not quite announced yet. But those guys, you know, that's a good service for getting in alongside you and your professionals and looking at ways of structuring some of the stuff and getting the conversation going. And one point I probably failed to note there with that that second example I gave you there, there was a lot of pushback from the professionals involved around that deal on the way through. And you know, I know it's certainly their job to demonstrate the risks in any particular proposal and to work through it. But there comes a time that if that's what people want to do and they just keep getting no, 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 maybe they need to look at moving those professionals on. And that's what happened in that case. We actually couldn't get the answer they wanted. They found some people that were prepared to look outside the square. And I think you find when you get into it, everyone's really keen to tell you why you can't do something. They need to look at the other side of the equation. For the guys coming through, the FMP, EDP management programs, great start, gets you thinking. I was lucky enough to do the FMP program last year and got a heap out of it. So if you ever get that opportunity, really good way of opening your mind a bit. And that's backed up with things like our FAR research team and some other initiatives are on the way. So just to conclude, look, we all know that the industry needs young blood. It's here, it's there and it's keen. We've just got to keep it retained and find them a way in. And we can do better at that. I know we can do better at that. But we've just got to keep communicating and working at it until we get the answer. And like it's very rare that we come to the first answer straight away. You know, you have to bounce these things around for quite a period of time before you get something that works. You've got to be innovative, and obviously it has to work for both parties. You know, there's got to be a win on each side of the fence. I certainly wouldn't underestimate the power of actually being able to shift some of that ownership, even if it's a small stake, to some of your staff on the way through. Or family. That benefit of having that bit of skin in the game, you'll see massive results. And finally, you know, we have got an exciting future here. I'm really confident of that, and I know we can actually drive this industry forward. We've just got to think differently about how we do it. So that's me. The rent for the farm was just based on a stock unit basis at a market level. It was tweaked a little bit so that it worked for both parties, But it was based around the level of drawings that the farmer exiting the farm needed. You know, we had to make sure that we could maintain a lifestyle that they were happy and comfortable with. That probably dictated most of it.
All the examples you were mostly you talked about the scale.
What yep.
What scale do you think you require?
Look, these days, certainly the bigger the better. Like if you think about it and you say that, say for argument's sake, we're grossing $120, $130 a stock unit, and at the moment we've got costs of, say, $70-odd a stock unit. So maybe there's $50-$60 in between, and out of that we've got to take our lease and we've got to take our interest cost. Yeah, so by the time we do that, yeah, there may only be a margin there of $20 or $30 a stock unit currently. So to me, unless you've got, you know, 5,000-odd stock units there or thereabouts, it's hard to get much more than $100-odd grand coming out the bottom. And to me, I think you need that as a minimum to be able to, you know, you've got to be able to actually generate enough cash to grow and go forward. There's not a lot of point just getting into a lease that you can pay your way and you make a living, but you can't see your way forward at the end of it. It's got to do better than that. And to be fair, we need to push those profitability stats at the same time. But, yeah. Yep. There certainly will have been. Look, I think there's a heck of a lot. We're a heck of a lot better at it than what we were when we started, and probably particularly with equity partnerships. Like everybody knows the stories there. But yeah, you've got to remember where we started from. There was a huge amount of city money and cash that came in from outside of farming that really didn't understand it at the time, and. It was all about the numbers. There was much less emphasis actually placed on the people on the way through that. Whereas for any of these things to work, the numbers come last, the people come first. And when you find the right guys and the right mix, then you've got something. So we spend a lot of time trying to actually find those right people that are gonna get on and have got aligned visions and values. And once we've got them, then we go and figure out what we can do. And I think attacking it from that approach rather than gee, there's a farm on the market, shit, we better find some equity. It's a much more successful type approach. But yeah, certainly you've got to be careful.
That first example where that leasee was actually buying into the property eventually.
Yep.
Why was the lease initiated and not a progressive purchase to start with?
Well, I guess they were able to buy 14% up front. So that's a start. They did give them something in the company as a foothold. It's probably a chunk of it comes down to a lease is cheaper than interest as a general rule. It's probably changed a little bit over recent years, but if you sort of think about it, a lease is typically 3-4% of the capital value of a property. Interest could be, on a long-term basis, could be 7 or 8%. So you're sort of getting extra cash generated on the way through, which certainly helps. And in any of these situations, it's got to be about generating as much profit as you can on the way through. So I guess they could have gone harder up front and bought a bigger stake, but that lines my pocket more than it lines theirs. And you know, where they're looking at generating, getting ahead, they really got to be doing that from cash. So that was just the option that was taken in that case.
So that sounded to me a bit like a banker encouraging people to borrow less, which is probably sounds like unselfish advice. Thank you, Richard. And people did mention a little bit yesterday that sometimes the bankers don't understand deer as well as they do other systems, but I know for a fact that if you go to Richard, he knows what you're talking about in deer.